Hi, my name is Ana Beatriz Cholo. I'm with Capital in Maine, and we're here tonight with Erin Aubry Kaplan, the author of I Heart Obama or I Love Obama?
I Heart Obama. There's
I
a difference.
I Heart Obama. Okay. Yeah. What is the difference?
Oh, well, you know, Heart is a little more intense than I Love, or you. I guess they're sort of interchangeable, but I really wanted that symbol there, you know, the actual heart. I think it says, it speaks a lot more than to just, you know, love. You can say, I love pizza, but this is a different kind of connection. The title's a little bit tongue-in-cheek, as I hope you discovered reading the book,
yes.
Because what I lay out is you know, I really feel, and I still feel, an intense connection to Obama. I mean, I've been writing about politics and black folk for a long time, but I was just kind of going along and not really excited by politics at all, frankly. I'm the same age as Obama, and I just had, you know, sort of been, you know, I've been on autopilot a long time with elected officials, and but when he came along, he just kind of shook up my torpor, I guess.
Who did you write this book for?
Oh, for me. I was trying to figure out what I thought, you know.
Did you write it for black people?
I guess, yes, I did. I really wanted us to hear each other. That's what I did. Because, you know, I go here, I go there, I hear this conversation, that conversation. I feel, you know, I feel in that way like a reporter all the time. And I feel like I carry all these. I wanted to have people sort of talking to each other in the book. And to hold up a mirror or not a mirror, but almost a microphone, and let them hear what they have to say. You know, let everybody hear what everyone else is saying. All these conversations I kind of took for granted all these years. And then when I, of course, you sit down and write it, it takes on a different life and takes on a different meaning. And I saw all these connections and I saw all these sort of very interesting subtleties. And, you know, and I wanted other people to see that. I wanted, I wanted them to know how important their opinion is. Because I think so often, you know, black opinion doesn't matter. Unlike all the other firsts we've had in history, like I bring up Jackie Robinson quite a bit. Many people have.
And you bring up the boxer, Joe.
Oh, Joe Lewis.
Joe Lewis.
Yeah, so the difference between Obama and those firsts, you know, those firsts is that, you know, Jackie Robinson, when he integrated baseball, he knew how to play baseball. He just, all he had to survive was the threats and the taunts and, you know, and, but his skills were there. There was no doubt about that. He didn't have to create that. Obama gets into office, becomes president, and then he's got to figure out how to be president, and can he be president, and how's that? So he has to actually invent the job as he goes along, and so that's extraordinarily difficult. So he needs cooperation from other people, and he's not getting it, so it's a very different dynamic. He can't be president unless people help him be president, you know?
What do you think Malcolm X would think about
that? That's a wonderful question.
I'm really curious about. And maybe even Martin Luther King.
That's another very good question, because he is so often compared to, mostly to Martin Luther King. But I've seen his image right there in the pantheon of images of black heroes, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and there's Obama. I would say, I mean, hard to say, Malcolm X, I think, might see Obama as this sort of capitulation, as maybe I hate to say it, and I'm guessing, because we don't know what Malcolm X
said. No, we don't. But we'll never know.
No, we'll never know. But I think Malcolm X would say that he is sort of a distraction. He is... you know, just some other critic in the book calls Obama the kind of the black face of empire. He is, yes, you know, he has succeeded, but he's been totally absorbed into the system and can do nothing for us. Because Malcolm X, you know, didn't believe in the American project.
You also bring up a common refrain that's been heard a lot throughout his presidency. And maybe it's come up more amongst black people. Mm-hmm. Is he black enough?
Oh gosh, that was a white conversation.
Oh, was it? Okay.
You know, well, with black people, the question it was a little different. When he was a candidate, for white people, the question was literally genetically, is he black enough? He's half white, so what does that mean? Mm-hmm. Black people don't have any problem with him being half white. Most of us have some mix of some. You know, no one's pure African.
Well, his mother.
Sure.
You said that you called that a delicious moment when.
Oh yeah, delicious
his mother
irony.
Yes.
His white mother is actually descended from. technically the first legal slave in the country. I think that's great.
That's right. That was incredible. I had no idea.
And me, to just kind of, it didn't really focus on that.
I had no idea.
I didn't either.
Yeah.
And the genealogists were just kind of poking around and just sort of stumbled across this, which I think is perfect. But yes. Anyway. So his
mother's black, so by virtue of the one drop rule.
There you go. Anyway, and not just any black person, the first legal black slave in the country.
Yeah.
It's great. But anyway, this conversation around Obama's blackness for, I think, non-black people was, well, but, you know, is he really black since he's got some white? That's a question that people who aren't familiar with racial history, that's a question they ask. For black people, the question was, experientially, is he black enough? You know, mm-hmm. will he, you know, is he consciously black enough to recognize our crisis, to empathize with our issues? It was that kind of, you know,
or
question.
Or even, will he fight? Because you brought up how...
Will he fight?
Will he fight?
Will he fight at all, let alone for us?
But he is Trayvon Martin.
He is Trayvon Martin.
Could have been, and that was a pivotal moment for you.
Yeah, I mean, so he outed himself as a black man. Good for him. You know, he kind of, he was so tortured by even having to say it. I felt, oh, it's about time. At the same time, I felt, oh.
It shouldn't have been this hard.
Yeah, it shouldn't have been this hard. It speaks more to our crazy racial politics than it does to him. But he did do it.
You haven't always been happy with his accomplishments, but healthcare was a huge one, and he took a big risk.
Took a huge risk right away.
Yeah, right away.
His first year in office.
His first year, yeah.
Yes, and that was something he did. That was something he did hold firm on. Although some people I talked to said that's when they lost faith, when he gave away the public option. They thought, oh. That's where they lost him early. But it all depends on how you look at it. Many people said, but at least he's a president who finally got some reform through. Many presidents tried and failed since Roosevelt, you know, tried and failed to, you know, Clinton, you know, Hillary Clinton famously tried to.
Sure.
And just couldn't get it through. And here's Obama, a new guy who gets instant and intense opposition, and yet he pushed through a version of what he wanted, a version. And I think that, you know, kind of settling for what you can get is another thing black people understand. You settle for what you can get, and you try for the ideal. And not achieving the ideal is not considered shameful, not considered a failure, but kind of just the way things work in this country.
Well, it's been a pleasure. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Oh, thanks, Anna. I enjoyed myself.
Likewise.
Yeah.